Good morning. Today's practical class is on the clinical examination of the respiratory system. This is performed to assess the function of the respiratory tract and the lungs. It should be carried out methodically because this provides so much sufficient information for the diagnosis of the pathology of the lungs. So it also to interpret and correlate the disease process. So it helps to interpret and correlate the findings of the clinical position with the disease process. So before going to this, you should know few anatomical landmarks. So what are all the anatomical different lines, what are the different prominences, and then what are the important areas, what are the different borders, different lung fissures and the borders. So all this you should know. So the mid sternal line, so this is the vertical line which is drawn through the center of the sternum and manubrium. Mid clavicular line, this is the vertical line which runs parallel to the mid sternal line. And this is the line which is drawn from the center of the clavicle. And the center of the clavicle is determined by the tip of the acromion process and the sternoclavicular, so suprasternal notch. So the midpoint between these two is your the center of the clavicle, and draw a vertical line from here. So that is the mid clavicular line. Anterior axillary line. That is from the anterior axillary fold, a vertical line is drawn. That is the anterior axillary line. Draw a vertical line from the posterior axillary line. That is the posterior axillary fold. That is the posterior axillary line. In between the midpoint of these two lines, anterior axillary and posterior axillary, the midpoint of these two, draw a vertical line. So that vertical line is called the mid axillary line. And then the mid spinal and the mid scapular line. Mid spinal means this is the line which is drawn through the center of the spinous process of the vertebra. So that is the center of the back. That is the mid spinal line. And mid scapular line is the vertical line which is on the posterior aspect of the chest that runs parallel to the mid spinal line and extends through the apices of the scapula, mid scapular line. Areas: supraclavicular, infraclavicular, mammary, inframammary, axillary, infraaxillary, suprascapular, interscapular, and infrascapular. So these are the important areas. Next, prominences. The main one is the sternal angle, suprasternal notch, and then vertebral prominences. So sternal angle, it is also called the Ludwig's angle or angle of Louis. So this is the transverse ridge that is present in the anterior part of the chest. So this where the articulation of the sternum and manubrium occurs. So the articulation of sternum and manubrium, so this forms a transverse ridge that is called the sternal angle. The importance of the sternal angle is at this site, that is the sternal angle, the second costal cartilage articulates with the sternum. So the rib which corresponds to this sternal angle is the second rib. The space below the second rib is the second intercostal space. So this sternal angle helpful for to identify the intercostal space. So not only this, we have other importance of this, that is the trachea bifurcates into two main bronchi at this site. The upper border of the atria of the heart, that also corresponds to this site. And then the anterior borders of the lungs meet in the midline at this point. And then in the back, the disc between the fourth and fifth thoracic vertebra corresponds to this site. That is the importance of the sternal angle. and then the vertebral prominence, that is at the back, the spinous process of the 7th cervical vertebra is prominent. And one more is the suprasternal notch. So this is above the tip of the manubrium. A notch is present, that is called the suprasternal notch. So that's about the prominences. Then coming to the lung fissure and borders. So lung fissures, that is we have the oblique fissure and the horizontal fissure. Oblique fissure is called the major and the horizontal fissure is the minor interlobar fissure. So oblique fissure, it starts from the second thoracic spine posteriorly and extends obliquely downwards and forwards to the sixth costochondral junction anteriorly. Horizontal fissure, it starts from the right fourth costochondral junction and passes horizontally to meet the oblique fissure in the mid axillary line. So horizontal fissure is present only in the right side. So left side, above the oblique fissure is the upper lobe, below the oblique fissure is the lower lobe. Right side, above the horizontal fissure is the upper lobe, below the oblique fissure is the lower lobe. In between the horizontal and the oblique is the middle lobe. And then coming to the borders of the lung, upper border and the lower border. Upper border of the lung, that is 5 cm above the sternoclavicular joint. Lower border of the lung differs in different areas. In the anterior, that is the midclavicular line up to 6th rib, in the mid-axillary line up to 8th rib, and the mid-scapular line, it is up to 10th rib. So that's about the important landmarks you should know before doing the systemic examination. So next we'll come to the method of examination. That is, this the systemic examination of the respiratory system is carried in under four steps, that is inspection, palpation, percussion and auscultation. So inspection means you are just seeing. So palpation, that is you have to palpate, you have to touch the areas, and then percussion, and then auscultation. Auscultation means by using the stethoscope, you have to auscultate all the areas which I mentioned earlier. So you should examine all these areas, and this examination should be you should do it in order. That is inspection first, then palpation, percussion, and auscultation. So, and the major important requirements here is only stethoscope and the measuring tape. So before doing any systemic examination, you should first always do the general physical examination, because so it gives a clue to the diagnosis. So the findings which you are getting in general physical examination, so that may give a clue for a respiratory pathology, or these are the things that is which is shown in the PPT. That means, so if these are findings are present, then you should look for any respiratory pathology. That is, if there is any pallor, so paleness of the skin, mucous membrane, so blood loss. So it may be due to hemoptysis. Hemoptysis means coughing out of the blood. So if there is any respiratory pathology like bronchogenic carcinoma, there will be coughing out of blood. So like that, so if pallor is there, you should think of some respiratory pathology as well. If cyanosis is present, bluish discoloration, so, and then if clubbing is there, that is bulbous enlargement of the fingers and toes, that is terminal phalanx of the fingers and toes. So cyanosis, that is seen in so many respiratory disorders, that is bronchogenic carcinoma, lung abscess, emphysema, chronic obstructive lung disorder, chronic smokers also. So all these are the causes for the clubbing. And look for any lymph node enlargement, because in the lymph node, if there is any carcinoma lung, so that may spread to the lymph nodes. So if there is any lymph node enlargement, so all these you should look while doing the general physical examination, which gives a clue for the diagnosis. That is, If these things are present, you should think that there is some respiratory pathology. So that's about the general physical examination. So first thing, okay, now we'll go to the systemic examination. So that is the first thing in inspection. You should look for the shape of the chest. It should be bilaterally symmetrical, and on cross section it looks elliptical. That is, the transverse diameter is more than that of the AP anteroposterior diameter in the ratio of 7:5. So that is the shape of the chest. So so first I will tell the normal things, then we'll go for the applied aspects. So first look for the shape of the chest, and then the symmetry of the chest. That is, the chest should be bilaterally symmetrical. That means it should not be bulged on one side, or it should not be depressed on the one side. And then look for the movements of the chest and the respiratory movements. So observe whether the chest moves normally and symmetrically equal on both the sides. It should move equal on both the sides. And if there is any pathology, the movement may be restricted on one side. And then look for the respiratory movements, that is the rate, depth, and then regular rhythm and the type. So rate, it should be 12 to 16 beats per minute, and then rhythm, it should be normal. Okay, look for any regular or irregular rhythm, and look for the depth of the respiration. The respiration may be decreased unilaterally or on both the sides. And look for the type of respiration, whether it is abdominothoracic or thoracoabdominal. Abdominothoracic is seen in males, thoracoabdominal is seen in females. That is, the respiration is predominantly, whether the respiration is predominantly abdomen or thoracic. So these are the things you should see in inspection of the chest. So this is the inspection. So next, in inspection, you should also see, look for the position of the media. Just look for the position of the mediastinum. So this is, this will be tested by seeing the position of the trachea and position of the apex beat. That is, just look for the position of the trachea. It should be centrally placed, or it should be, it will be little deviated to the right side. That is normal. And then look for the position of the apex beat. Apex beat is nothing but, it is the lowermost and outermost part of the heart. So that corresponds to the left ventricle. And this apex beat is usually present in the half an inch medial to the midclavicular line in the fifth intercostal space. So intercostal space you will identify by the sternal angle. So that is the position of the apex beat. So look for the position of the mediastinum as well. So this is about the inspection. So coming to the palpation, first you have to look for the expansion of the chest. So this is done by placing two palms firmly on both the sides of the chest and opposing the thumbs in the midline anteriorly, and then ask the subject to take a deep breath, and the movement of the thumbs away from the midline is observed. So in the base of the lungs, the distance, that is the extent of expansion, will be more than 5 cm in the base of the lungs, and in the apex it will be less. So this you should demonstrate, expansion of the chest. So you should place firmly the two palms in two forms on both the sides of the chest and opposing the thumbs in the midline. Ask the subject to take deep breath and note the expansion. So base of the lungs it should be more than 5 cm. So then look for the position of the mediastinum. So position of the trachea. So position of the trachea can be detected in three ways. The first way is place the tip of the index and ring finger over the sternoclavicular joint, and then with the middle finger place this middle finger in the suprasternal notch, and then feel for the tracheal rings. So the position of the trachea is determined by observing the spaces between the finger tips. So if it is deviated, so that will be narrowed. So that is one method of finding the position of the apex bead. The other one is, so palpate the space between the anterior border of the sternocleidomastoid muscle and the trachea. So if the space is narrowed, that means the trachea is shifted to that side. And then one more method, okay, the position of the trachea is will be detected in these three ways. So one more method is place the index finger firmly into the suprasternal notch and locate the tracheal rings in relation to the sternum. So that is one method of finding the position of the trachea. Next, the position of the apex bead, that is to know the shift of the mediastinum. So the position of the apex bead, so you can done this in supine posture, sitting posture, or sitting and bending forward. So first place the palm on the precordium to feel the apical impulse. So precordium in the sense is the anterior part of the chest wall which overlies the heart, and then by placing the ulnar border of the palm on the pulsation area horizontally. Finally, the apex is localized by the tip of the middle or the index finger. So that is how you should know, you should detect the apex bead. Usually it is present half an inch medial to the midclavicular line in the fifth intercostal space. So this is to know the position of the mediastinum. And then the applied aspect will be, I will tell later. So next is the occal fremitus. So this is also very important, that is we should ask the subject to sit and relax, then ask the subject to tell the words 11 or 99 repeatedly. So while he is telling the words, while he is speaking, so the vibrations, so this is transmitted to the chest wall. So the vibration is conducted from the larynx by the trachea and bronchi to the smaller tubes within the lungs, and then through the lung tissues to the chest wall. And then while speaking, you can feel the vibrations by placing the palm over the chest, okay, over the chest. And you should do simultaneously, you should compare on the both the sides. Either it will be normal or increased or decreased. So that is about the occal fremitus. The tenderness is, the pain is a symptom and tenderness is a sign. That is, when you palpate over the areas, if the subject is experiences pain, so that is the tenderness. So then palpate over the areas. So if he complains of pain while touching, so that is the tenderness, and look for tenderness. Because of so many pathological conditions of the lungs, you will see the tenderness. And then the percussion. So percussion is done to demonstrate the nature of changes of lung tissues, bronchi and pleura. So this shows whether the lung tissues contains less or more air than the normal, or whether any fluid is present. So this you should done, all these things you should done in all the areas which I mentioned previously, how the areas are differentiated. So here what we have to do, you have to place the left hand, okay? So the middle finger of the left hand, okay, that is called the plexometer finger. So this plexometer finger you should firmly place on the surface of the chest, usually in the intercostal space. So place only the plexometer finger firmly on the surface of the chest in the intercostal space. And then the middle finger of the right hand, that is called the plexor. So this should firmly strike over the middle phalanx of the plexometer finger. So the movement should be only at the wrist joint, not at the elbow, wrist and the finger joints. It should be free movement. So it should be immediate, it should, the finger should be taken out immediately after strike. So these are all the rules of percussion. So when you're percussing over the axilla, so ask the subject to lift his hands on his head, and when you're percussing over the back, ask the subject to place the right hand on the left shoulder and ask the left hand on the right shoulder. So it will be easy for the examiner to percuss. So the rules of percussion is very important. So these are the rules. The plexometer finger should be placed firmly on the chest, and then the plexor, that is the right hand middle finger, so this, it should strike on the middle phalanx of the plexometer finger. It should be taken out immediately after striking. The movement should be only at the wrist joint. It should be perpendicular. It should be free. So all these are the rules of percussion. Then the last one is the auscultation. So this is expressed as the normal resonance, hyper resonance, or less resonant, or dullness, stony dullness. So all these are percussion is expressed in these ways. So if there is any pathology, there may be hyper resonance or dullness. So that will be dealt later. And then the last, you have to auscultate. That is the auscultation by using the stethoscope. So place the stethoscope firmly over all the areas of the chest and look for and listen to the sounds. So the sounds which are listened, so you should look for the intensity and the character of the sound. So that is one thing. And then see for occult resonance. So these are the different types of breath sounds, vesicular and bronchial. And then look for the vocal resonance, and look for any added sounds. So vocal resonance is nothing but it is the counterpart of vocal fremitus. That is, you are in palpation, you are palpating and then looking for the vocal fremitus, whereas if you are auscultating, that is called the vocal resonance. So just in vocal fremitus, place the hand, whereas vocal resonance, you just use the stethoscope and same procedure. That is, ask the subject to tell 1-1 and then simultaneously auscultate, and then simultaneously compare with the opposite side, whether it is more on one side or whether it is less on the other side. So that is called the vocal resonance. So this is the basic examination of the respiratory system. So now we'll see the why we have to do all this test while doing. Okay, you should look for the intensity and character of the, while auscultating, you should look for the intensity and the character of the sound. So these are all applied aspects. I will tell it in later. Okay, so thank you.